Hello, everybody, and good morning and happy Mother's Day. I'm Ingrid Hudson, the Director of Children and Family Ministries here at Christ Our Shepherd Lutheran Church, and we're having a wonderful Mother's Day out at Palmetto Road at our 10:30 service. If you weren't able to make it this morning, we are going to be showing you our fantastic Mother's Day service from last year. Thank you so much for tuning in.
Well, the Lord be with you. Welcome to worship this day that the Lord has made. If you're here in Fayette or Coweta counties, thanks for coming to this sanctuary. Thanks for worshiping with us online. Or if you're in another state, thank you very much for tuning in to Christ Our Shepherd Lutheran Church. On this Mother's Day, happy Mother's Day to all the moms with us. We're going to have a little fun in our sermon today, comparing a mother's love to the way God loves us. And we're going to do a trio tag team sermon today. And so delighted that you will get to hear again from Director of Children and Family Ministry, Ingrid Hudson. So Ingrid, thanks for being with us again today. If you think about it, that's sort of God's design for us, right? He sort of puts us in small groups, led by a mom and a dad, and we don't have to be all by ourselves out in a big country or state. And so, too, we know that's the way it is with churches. It's great to be a part of a church, but so much good stuff happens in a small group. If you are not part of a small group and would just like a little help in figuring out what might be a good one for you, Barbara Anderson is our Director of Connecting Ministry. Please give her a call. If you are a leader of a small group, we thank all the leaders who make those things happen, those groups happen, this Tuesday night or on Wednesday afternoon. We've got a small group leader powwow, and we hope that you leaders can come together and we'll share resources. How are things going? What is small group life like post-pandemic as we sort of make our way out of this? So sign up for that. Blood drive this Friday. From 1 to 6 in our fellowship hall. The Red Cross always does a great job keeping things safe. Maybe I'll see you at 2:30 because that's when I give. Thanks for considering that. Vacation Bible School. Ingrid, you're saying, boy, we're getting almost to our max. We're excited about that this summer. Luther Road is a sort of a camp experience where these young college kids, camp counselors, they come to our facility and do Luther Road Camp. We've got high school mission trips, First Communion classes, so take a look at all those opportunities. If you are at home, please know that we have communion. Our theology is we do worship via word and sacrament. And so if you're at home, go ahead and set aside a little bread, wine, grape juice, and please participate with us in just a few moments. If you asked, hey, how did that event on Tuesday go? The ELCA Senior Pastors of Larger Congregation Conference. And it went really, really well. You might remember a tornado came through Atlanta, so our internet was down on Monday. And we were a little worried, but we scrambled. And I was really proud of this congregation that over the last year we have made some decisions and some acquisitions and some training to the point that we were able to host a webinar for senior pastors across the country. And we were able to have our presiding bishop, Liz Eaton, bring greetings from Chicago. And we were able to have the bishop of Puerto Rico, where we were supposed to go. Had it not been canceled, we had fun. We were at Puerto Zumo instead. But she brought us greetings, and that worked. And we had worship songs from congregations around the country and devotions from different pastors. Our keynote speaker was from Maryland, and then we bounced to Chicago where we had ELCA leaders give a little bit of a response. It was really, really a neat day, but I want to thank our technology team and this congregation for stepping up and being the kind of church that can do something like that. Was really proud of you. And then again, if you're a visitor with us, thanks for being here. Let us know how we can be helpful to you. Every Thursday, if you want to sign up for it, we have an email that goes out and tries to explain all the ways you can connect. A variety of things coming down the pike. So with that, I invite you to stand as you're able for our thanksgiving of baptism. Refreshed by the resurrection life we share in Christ, let us now give thanks for the gift of baptism. We thank you, risen Christ, for these waters where you make us new, leading us from death to life, from tears to joy. We bless you, risen Christ, that your Spirit comes to us in the grace-filled waters of rebirth, like rains to our thirsting earth, like streams that revive our souls, like cups of cool water shared with strangers. Breathe your peace on your church when we hide in fear. Clothe us with your mercy and forgiveness. Send us companions on our journey as we share your life. Make us one, risen Christ. Cleanse our hearts. Shower us with life. To you be given all praise with the Holy Spirit in the glory of God, now and forever. Amen. Of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. O God, you have prepared for those who love you joys beyond understanding. Pour into our hearts such love for you that, loving you above all else, we may obtain your promises, which exceed all we can desire. Through Jesus Christ, your Son and our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated for our dialogue.
Our dialogue for Mother's Day comes from Old Testament books, Genesis, Hosea, Deuteronomy, and Isaiah.
Humankind was created as God's reflection. In the divine image, God created them, female and male. God made them.
I led them with cords of human kindness, with bands of love. I was to them like those who lift infants to their cheeks.
I bent down to them and fed them. Like the eagle that stirs up its nest and hovers over its young, God spreads wings to catch you and carries you on pinions.
You were mindful of the rock that bore you.
You forgot God who gave you birth.
Can a woman forget her nursing child or show no compassion for the child of her womb?
Even these may forget.
Yet I will not forget you.
Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Second chapter. Now every year his parents went to Jerusalem for the festival of the Passover. And when Jesus was 12 years old, they went up as usual for the festival. When the festival was ended and they started to return, the boy Jesus stayed behind in Jerusalem. But his parents did not know it. Assuming that he was in the group of travelers, they went a day's journey. Then they started to look for him among their relatives and friends. When they did not find him, they returned to Jerusalem to search for him. After 3 days, they found him in the temple, sitting among the teachers, listening to them and asking them questions. And all who heard him were amazed at his understanding and his answers. When his parents saw him, they were astonished, and his mother said to him, "Child, why have you treated us like this? Look, your father and I have been searching for you in great anxiety." He said to them, "Why were you searching for me? Did you not know that I must be in my father's house?" But they did not understand what he said to them. Then he went down with them and came to Nazareth and was obedient to them. His mother treasured all these things in her heart. And Jesus increased in wisdom and in years and in divine and human favor. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. Well, may the words of our mouths and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. As I said, I'm grateful that I get to do this sermon as a trio tag team sermon today. And again, Ingrid Hudson, Director of Children and Family Ministry, thanks for joining the pastors today on this. For my section of the sermon, I would like to celebrate the wonders of motherhood throughout nature, because so often the scripture is excited to talk about God's love with an analogy from God's incredible kingdom of nature. In Hosea 13, God's protective love for us is compared to a mother bear. "Like a bear robbed of her cubs, I will attack anyone who threatens you." Or in Deuteronomy, "Like the eagle that stirs up its nest and hovers over its young, God spreads wings to catch you and carries you on pinions." Jesus himself chooses to compare his passion for us to that of a mother hen. Jerusalem, how often have I desired to gather your children together as a hen gathers her brood under her wings. Well, in our weekly creed, and we're going to today, we start, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. So let's have some fun looking at that creation and see what we learn. I need your help. When I point to you, would you declare a mother's love like God's love? So let's practice that. A mother's love like God's love. All right. First, let's take a look at the orangutan. The bond between an orangutan mother and her young is one of the strongest in nature. During the first 2 years of life, the young rely entirely on their mothers for food and transport. Moms stay with their young for 6 to 7 years, teaching them where to find food and how to build a sleeping nest. Orangutans are known to visit their moms until they are 15 or 16 years old. So we praise God's love, like God's love, is with us for the long haul. Secondly, polar bears. You northern transplants know how cold the snow can get. So thank goodness a polar bear mom does all the right things to keep her twin cubs warm with milk, body heat, and specially designed dens. Born between November and December, the cubs leave the den in March and April to get used to the outside temperature before learning to hunt. So we praise God that a mother's love, like God's love, despite the world getting cold and chilly so often, can keep us warm in wonderful ways. African elephant. Elephants live in matriarchal societies, so the females in the social group will help the calf get to its feet after birth. Elephant mothers are especially affectionate with their young, with older elephants adjusting the pace of the whole herd so that the calves can keep stride. So we praise God that a mother's love, like God's love, is willing to adjust to our pace, even when we get off track and stumble way too often. How about a cheetah? Cheetah mothers raise their young in isolation. After months of training hunters, the cheetah cubs finally leave their moms, but they will form a sibling group for the next 6 months. What I found fascinating is that until then, mothers move the litter every 4 days to prevent a buildup of smell that the predators can discern and use to attack. So we praise God that is always working hard to steer us away from danger and into the greener pastures of life. A worshiper after the sermon said, "Hey, I thought you were going to say and keep us out of our own stink," but I thought that was good. Just two more. Emperor penguin. After laying an egg, the mother emperor penguin leaves it with its partner, male, but while the guy just stands around to keep the egg warm, the mother has to waddle up to 50 miles to reach the ocean. I'll say that again. While the guy just stands around, the mother has to waddle up to 50 miles to start fishing for breakfast, lunch, and dinner, and then up to 50 miles back to the hatching site to regurgitate the food to the newly hatched chicks. Using the warmth of her own brood pouch, the mother keeps the chicks warm and safe. So we praise God that is willing to go to great distances for our sake. Well, finally, moms think that 9 months is a long pregnancy, but a deep sea octo mom was recorded by the Monterey Bay Aquarium Research Institute to brood her eggs for 53 months or almost 4.5 years. This is the longest incubation period of any animal, both in terms of absolute and also in proportion to the lifespan of the animal. So most octopuses, for instance, live only 1 to 2 years. So this octopus brooded her eggs for the equivalent of 4 lifetimes. For a human, this would be like being pregnant for over 300 years. So we praise God that God's love, like God's love, causes our jaws to drop in amazement and appreciation. End of part one. Part two, Ingrid.
Well, grace and peace to each one of you on this beautiful Mother's Day. I say beautiful not because it's a gorgeous, sunshiny day, which I'm so thankful that it is. I say beautiful because a mother's love is just that, beautiful. When Pastor Fritz asked me about giving a small message for Mother's Day, I wasn't sure what I was going to say. Not because I didn't have anything to say, but because I had too much to say. And like I have done since I was in middle school, when asked to write something, I immediately called my parents to be my sounding boards. I chatted with my mom about what Mother's Day can mean to some. It can be a difficult day for those who have lost their mothers, a mother who has lost a child, or couples who desperately want to become parents. I also talked to my dad, who lost his mother at a fairly young age. I asked him if Mother's Day was a difficult day in the years after she had passed. And he said, no, it is a day to celebrate the love my mother had for me and the love that all mothers have for their children. So on this Mother's Day, I choose to focus on that, the never-ending love of a mother, which I can only imagine is a wonderful preview of God's love for each one of us. Now, like many of us, it had been a while since I was able to visit with my mom. But she flew in for my son's 4th birthday at the end of April after so much time apart. The first night she was here, my sermon kind of wrote itself because my children insisted that they sleep with her. So she and I both laid with them and rocked them to sleep. Like my mom sang to my 5 sisters and me each night, together, she, my 2 young boys, and I sang the Lord's Prayer before they drifted off to sleep. The prayer she and my dad had taught me, the prayer my husband and I have taught our children, and the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples. It really wasn't a big deal in the sense that that's what we do and how we go to bed each and every night. But of course it was and is a big deal in the scheme of my life and my children's lives. The way my mom has always lived her life, the way she taught us all about God and Jesus in both big and small ways, how she interacts with others, teaches others, shows God's love to others, was and is such a testimony on my faith journey. And as I have stepped into this new role as Director of Children and Family Ministries, I'm often asked by parents, well, what books do you recommend? Or what curriculum should we be following at home? How can I better teach my children about God and Jesus? And while there are lots of wonderful resources that I can share, how we live our lives each and every day is the best way to show and teach our children about God's love. And while we will never fully comprehend the enormity of God's love for each of us, as I said before, I think mothers do get a pretty close preview. Lord knows, as parents, each day we are given an opportunity to love, to show patience, to show kindness, and to show compassion. So on this Mother's Day and every day, my prayer for each one of us is that God uses us to share his light and his love to the children he has so graciously entrusted to us. Amen.
Thank you very much, Ingrid, and thank you for being the director of our children and family ministry. It is a great joy to work with you and a great joy to meet your mom a couple of weeks ago. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you. Thank you for this time to come together to remember and celebrate the gift of children, the gift of mothers, the gift of parents. In the name of Christ we pray. Amen. Part one, Animal Kingdom. Part two, the joy of a scene that I will never forget from this point on of you, your mom, and your children, and brings back memories of my upbringing. Part three is, what about mothers in the Bible? A few little comments about that. First, that image that I love that Pastor Fritz included in the dialogue this morning is, how often have I desired to gather your children together as a hen gathers her brood under her wings. It's the scene of when Jesus is looking down over the temple and very close to the end of his life, and he's thinking about the sorrow that he has about the children of God that so much need what is about to happen in his own life and death and resurrection for us, but the sorrow that he felt and the worry wanting to bring them all together. You ought to look up sometime on the internet just to see some other pictures of animals protecting their children, and a lot of birds, not just hens, like to pull them all together to keep them warm and safe. But let's look at mothers in the Bible. First, in the Old Testament, you know, if you looked at all the mothers in the Old Testament, you've got a full range of some that are just the lights go off in heaven. They're so wonderful, but you have a whole lot more that really are rascals, a lot of them. Fierce, but rascals. But in chapter 31 of Proverbs, Proverbs mentions mothers a lot, mothers and fathers a lot. But in chapter 31, the whole thing really is a statement about mothers. The second part of it is the one that's more familiar to us, is that a godly wife is hard to find, is how the second section starts. And then it talks about what a mother does and a wife does. Oh, they get up early in the morning before anybody else in the household. They go to bed late after everybody else has gone to sleep. They take care of the children, make clothes for the children. They take care of them when it's cold, when it's hot. On and on about all this that a woman does, that a mother does. I have a friend that when she passed away, she had left her Bible to me. And in the crease of the Bible at that part in chapter 31 of Proverbs, she wrote, "You can tell that a man wrote this." I loved Aunt Elizabeth. She was awesome. The first part of it is the story of the woman who is her son has a leadership position referenced by king, though that word often in the Old Testament meant more than just a king. And so she starts out her section by talking to her son Lemuel. I'm going to fill in more than what you see on the screen because it goes like this. "Lemuel, O Lemuel, O son of my womb, son of my vows, son whom I have prayed for. Lemuel, O Lemuel, do not give yourself to wanton women, women who will take your power away from you. And do not give yourself to strong drink. For he who drinks too much forgets how to take care of others. Oh no, give beer and wine and alcohol to those in misery, those who are at death's door. Let them drink and forget their poverty and their misery. But you, O Lemuel, do not drink or give yourself to wanton women. But be strong. Look to the needs of the poor and the needy. Stand up and speak for those who cannot speak for themselves." What a message for a mother to long for a son or a daughter, to stand up and speak for those who cannot speak for themselves. Proverbs has a lot of stuff about mothers and fathers. Three examples, though, of women that came to Jesus, or someone that came on behalf of a woman to Jesus, all about healing. The first one, a woman, has come to Jesus pleading for the life and the healing of her son, which he is moved to compassion. Another one was when Jesus had gone, few of his disciples, to Peter's household, and Peter's wife's mother was very ill. And this little scene is interesting because Jesus heals her, and what does she do right after she heals? She gets up and gets food for the others. Always a little humor there. And then the other one is that Jesus happens upon a funeral that is happening and the death of an only son, and he is moved to compassion for the widow of Nain. And he says to her, "Do not weep." The end of that story is that the son is restored. And then you have a wonderful clip of a mother who is out there giving her gusto to get her two boys, to be in the lead. Some might, call that, a helicopter mom? Or you might call that the scene where the one that goes to the teacher and makes sure that goes to Jesus and says, "Hey, when you come into your kingdom, I want one of my sons on your right, one of my sons on the left." That scene is always almost like the scene with Jesus and his mother. In a moment, I'll tell you about that. But you wonder, the scene that you do see up high is, he does have someone on his right and on his left. Hardly, I think, like that mother was speaking of. Let's look at a few about Jesus and his mother. We've already read about the 12-year-old incident, and we know very well about the birth of Jesus and the angels and the shepherds and the moment at the end of chapter 2 in Luke. It says, "And Mary pondered what's happened in all this, pondered them in her heart." Shortly after that, we get 8 days later when he is being presented in the temple. And Simeon, an old man who has been waiting for such this day, he says to Mary, this is at the dedication of the child at 8 days old, to hear from this strong prophet in the moment, to say to her, "Your son, this child is destined to cause the rise and the fall of many, and a sword will pierce your own soul." What a statement when your infant is 8 days old to hear that your own soul is going to be pierced. And we do know that this woman later on loses her child. But before that, you do see that it is feisty woman here for sure. "Jesus, why did you do this to us? Why in the world did you stay behind? Here we are 3 days later. It took us to find you." I imagine that we are just getting the short version of the speech that she gave Jesus. Because notice the next part says, "And he went home with them and he was obedient." I just want to fill in the blanks so much sometimes in these conversations. Then you have Jesus, who is at the cross. When you talk about the elephants, Fritz, and you talked about that mothers will help a little baby elephant up to its feet, here you have a group of mothers who are around the cross with Mary. And at that moment is that Jesus is more concerned about his mother and says to John, "Here is your mother," and to her, his mother, "Here's your son," restoring for her that there's going to be someone, mom, linked up to you. But this is a scene of a mother losing her child and the others that are gathered around. I almost balked when Fritz asked me to be part of the sermon, because it does every year at Mother's Day, every year. It always worries me about the mothers for whom Mother's Day is not happy. And then this year on a personal level, for a couple of reasons, it particularly is reminiscent. And I know people in this room who have lost. And so thank you for being here to still celebrate and lift up the gift that motherhood is to our lives and to the strength of everyone's life, really. And then on Easter morning, still a group of mothers, similar to some that were mentioned before, there they are, not knowing that they are about to greet life instead of death. I think Jesus, God, always pointing us toward life beyond death. Like an eagle hovers over its young, God spreads his wings to catch us and to carry us, to love us. For he and our mothers and fathers want us to have the kind of courage to move forward, like an eagle who will not stay hovered somewhere in the storm underneath trees or something, but instead will climb above the clouds, climb above the storm to fly safely above it. You encourage me to enter the storm, to weather the storm, to lean into the howling winds. Then, like the eagle, you lift me up. You take the storms of life and use them to make me soar. You lead me to a place of peace, even if storms are still raging below. A beautiful way to look upon all of our lives and to the hopes and dreams that mothers have for their children. A few comments of just a modern day kind of prayer and blessing, a blessing to moms. Here's to the mom who keeps the plate spinning. Here's to the mom who keeps showing up on a field trip, the practice, the parent meeting, the recital, the fundraiser. Here's to the mom who shares her lunch, her phone, her closet, her pillow, her lap, her tears, her love. Here's to the mom whose time is no longer hers, who stays up tending to the fever of a child, who joins in the sidelines at the game a child is playing, who waits through a whole story, who pivots to rescue a teen, who claims that she's still up late at night, even if that's when the call comes from college, and to the mom who advocates for her child, whatever the problem is, who persists, who asks questions, who researches possibilities, anything to advocate for her child. Here's to the mom who's mothering while missing her own mom, who wishes for just one more conversation. Here's to the mom who's begging God to draw her child home, who's rescued and released 100 times, who's fought regret, confusion, and pain on her knees, a mom who knows what midnight prayer is like, but also knows what morning mercy is like. Here's that mom who counts on Jesus, knowing that Jesus will do in her what she cannot do by herself. So here's to moms.
Thank you.
together, let us confess our baptismal faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven, and he is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated for the prayers.
Alive in the risen Christ, by the power of the Holy Spirit, we bring our prayers before God, who promises to hear us and answer in steadfast love. Loving God, you call us to be your fruit-bearing church. Strengthen the bonds among all Christian churches. And today, we pray for the Moravian Church, giving thanks for the life and witness of Niklaus von Zinzendorf, renewer of the church and hymn writer. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great. Gracious God, as a mother comforts her child, you comfort us. Bless mothers and mothering people in our lives. Comfort those who miss their mothers, mothers who grieve, those who grieve because they cannot be mothers, and those who have never known a loving mother. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Faithful Savior, you conquer the world not with weapons, but with undying love. Plant your word in the hearts of the nation's leaders and give them your spirit, so that the peoples of the world may live in peace. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
You forget no one. You accompany the lonely. Be present with those who are sick or suffering. Provide for those needing homes or medical care, and point us toward life-changing responses to these needs in our communities. Be with the dying and those who care for them. Hear our prayers for these whom we name aloud and offer silently from our heart to you now.
McRoy family.
Leslie.
Andrew. Ryan. Robinson.
Shannon. Family. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
In the hope of new life in Christ, we raise our prayers to you, loving Lord, trusting in your never-ending goodness and mercy, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
We come to that time where we truly want you to know how grateful we are for the treasures that you share with us, and to be reminded of how you may give if you need that reminder. But it is because of your resources shared that we're able to come together for worship, and that we have a means by which we can have worship go into people's homes, a way to feed so many and to care for families, and to do that in this church and beyond our church and into areas that we wouldn't be able to go to ourselves. So again, thank you for what you do in this church and through this church. We also come now to that time, and I hope you at home, if you haven't gathered yet, some wine or juice and some bread of some kind, then do that so that we can share this meal that God has given to all of us. Please stand. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right. It's our duty, our joy, that at all times and in everywhere we offer thanks and praise to you, O God, through Jesus Christ, who by his death on the cross and his glorious resurrection, breaking the bonds of sin and death and giving life to all creation. And so with the church on earth, with all creation, with the host of heaven, we praise your name. For it was the night in which he was betrayed that our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks and broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup and he gave thanks and he gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Together, let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated. Let us share the feast. Children of God, you've been fed and nourished with the body and blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Be strengthened with his love and might as you walk with him each day in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Let us pray. Wellspring of joy, through this meal, you have put gladness in our hearts. We ask that you satisfy the hunger still around us. Send us as joyful witnesses that your love may bring joy to the hearts of all people through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And now may our glorious God grant you a spirit of wisdom to know and to love the risen Lord, the God of life, creation, creator, Son, and Holy Spirit. Bless you now and forever. Amen. Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed.
Alleluia.
So go in peace, share the good news, invite everyone to Jesus' pathway of joy and life. Alleluia.
Thanks be to God.
Alleluia. Alleluia.